So, thanks for joining today. My name is Emily Gorcenski. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about Data Mesh. Actually, what I am hoping to do is to show you the reference implementation that we have built for Data Mesh. It's, we built this on AWS. And I am here from ThoughtWorks. I serve currently as the service line lead for data and AI at ThoughtWorks Germany. And if you know anything about ThoughtWorks, we are a consultancy. We work in agile transformations, things like that. Over the years, we've kind of become known for building some new technology architectures, some new techniques, things like that. And one of them is Data Mesh. So Data Mesh came from Shamak Degani, who was until recently a thought worker. In 2019, she published an article on Martin Fowler's blog introducing the concept of a data mesh. Since that article sort of went viral, we've been doing a lot of development in Data Mesh, helping to help our clients understand what a data mesh is, how to build one, and what we need. This book, the Data Mesh book, is one of the many books that have come out of ThoughtWorks, and I think that since the book was published earlier this year, we've been doing a lot of talking about how to translate data mesh theory into practice. So that's hopefully what I will show you today. It was interesting because in the sort of around the conference, at the speaker events and things like that, I did a little bit of eavesdropping. Kind of everyone's talking about data mesh. They didn't know that I was standing next to them, kind of like siphoning their opinions and their thoughts on, is it a good thing? Is it a bad thing? Is it a new thing? Is it the right thing to build? When is it the right thing to build? And before I get into the actual implementation details, what I want to do is talk a little bit about what problem data mesh is trying to solve. Many organizations that we work with tend to have or tend to exhibit a number of common failure modes around their data systems and their data architectures. I'm not going to go through all of these. If you want to see more like Data Mesh 101, there's plenty of talks online. You can Google my name. You can Google Jamak. You can Google Data Mesh. There's plenty of this stuff. But basically, the hypothesis was that regardless of whether we've gone from data warehouses to data lakes to streaming architectures, cloud architectures, we've kind of been repeating the same patterns. We tend to think of data as a byproduct of our systems and processes. We tend to aggregate data capabilities in small centralized teams that quickly become bottlenecked. And we tend to build a system architecture that mimics Conway's law, that mimics the architectures that we have within our organization, which is that data folks are very separated from the people who are producing and consuming data. As a result, the semantic meaning of data gets separated by these centralized monolithic architectures. And so I think if there's an easy way for me to describe data mesh, it's not entirely correct, but it's close enough, it's that data mesh is kind of like the microservices of data architectures. A lot of people ask me, what is the difference between data mesh and data fabric? And I would say that data fabric is like the GraphQL of data architectures. When we built data mesh, when Jamak came up with the idea, she came up with these four key principles of data mesh. First, as with any microservice architecture, the products that you build must be domain-driven. So we sort of bring in domain-driven design and apply it to the data landscape. The second idea is that data is no longer a byproduct. We elevate data to be a product. What that means in practice is that we implement sort of product thinking when designing data products. That means we interview our users, we understand their needs, we build SLOs around the product, we give it the love and attention that any product deserves. Of course, this only works if you can have a self-service data infrastructure, meaning teams should be able to work autonomously with the data systems that you build. And then finally, because we are talking about spreading the capabilities throughout the organization, this opens up a really interesting governance question. Our response to that is that we want to restructure the way that we do governance to be a federated computational way of doing that, meaning you have representatives from the domains that own data. They come together, they set policies, and then you focus on automating those policies, building templates that allow independent and autonomous data teams to be compliant with your data policies. So what's interesting about this is that if you start looking deeper into implementing these principles, you can't just pick one. You can't say, like, I'm going to do this one. I'm going to create half of a data mesh. These are all interrelated. And this is a very complex diagram. But basically, what we see is that if you implement any one of these principles, it very quickly introduces a dependency onto another principle following the arrows. So if you try to implement just domain-oriented ownership, you will very soon see that you have challenges with needing to have data as a product, you need to have federated computational governance, and above all, you need a self-service data platform. And actually, if you look at this diagram, every path leads to this self-service data platform. So this is, in some way, the most important part of the data mesh transformation, is that you need to be able to work in a self-service manner. Now, anyone that has worked in cloud architectures knows what this looks like for software development. We're very good at doing Kubernetes and cloud and all of this other stuff where you can, you know, deploy a Docker container or whatever and have a service running and all that's fine. We've been doing that for years. But in data, we're still like funneling things into data lake architectures. We're still, you know, struggling with data warehouse and database administration and streams and the complexity and cost of processing on them. And so there's a lot of new thinking that we need to bring into how we actually build the data platform. So what the data mesh actually looks like in practice is something like this. You have these different domains, and each of these domains wraps a number of data products. Rather than using the platform as a mediating layer that sits in between data products, we actually connect data products directly to each other. So if I'm building a data product that is, I don't know, say building a recommendation engine, and I need transaction data, I don't go to some centralized source that somebody has dumped a bunch of data into to get that data. I speak directly to the team that's producing that data, and I figure out what are their SLOs around it, where does it live, et cetera, et cetera. Each one of these data products, which is shown by these sort of hexagonal things, which I will explain in a moment, has to have these six key properties. Some of you are probably familiar with like FAIR data. This is kind of an extension of the FAIR principles. It kind of decomposes them a little bit further. And so the idea is that each data product can define a certain SLO around each of these sort of properties, and then you can design your architectures to support whatever the given service levels you want to create for each of those data products. So things like discoverability, we can handle fairly easily, but things like trustworthiness, that's a little bit more complex. How do you define trustworthiness of your data? When we dive into the platform, what we actually do is we sort of separate the platform into three logical layers. Essentially, what we want to do is have sort of a mesh experience plane that's sitting at the top that has all of the capabilities for people to work with the data mesh, to be able to find data, to be able to discover the properties of data, things like that. We have sort of a data product developer plane in the middle. This is all of the tooling that we need to give people access to developing data products. And then finally, we have a platform layer. And that platform layer, or the utility plane, which is all sort of down here at the bottom, that utility plane is sort of our basic data architecture, right? So this is where you're going to put your Spark cluster and your storage layer and your data catalog, right? So all of that lives there. And what we want to do is we want to create the experience of working with this platform to be API driven, right? So you want to have APIs for us to, I don't know, register your data asset or your data product with a data catalog. You want APIs for searching for data, for connecting to the different data products. So what we actually build when we construct a data product is this sort of self-contained entity. At the end of the day, a data product is supposed to be a deployable unit. Much like a Docker container is a deployable unit of a piece of software, a data product should be a deployable unit of something that we can do to work with data. And what we have is, in the middle, we have these sort of three layers. This is your typical pipeline. This is your input processing and output layer. You can draft all sorts of analogies to conventional data architectures here. You can say we have bronze, silver, gold, red, yellow, green, whatever it is. But essentially, you have a layer that processes that takes your data in. You have a layer that transforms it in some way. You have a layer that makes it available. The layer that takes the data in, we call those input ports. These are fundamentally polyglot, so we should be able to connect to and read from many different types of data sources through standardized ways. We can have one or more input ports. These input ports can also connect to various legacy systems, such as SAP, a productivity suite, a data warehouse, etc. Or they can connect directly to the output ports of another data product. The output ports are also polyglot, so we can see data products that have multiple ways of emitting their data. We can build APIs to read from them. We can push data to a stream. We can write it to a database. We can dump it into a bucket and make it available in some way. And then, of course, the data product needs control ports, which gives us the APIs for doing things like discovery, lineage, access control, standardization, SLO compliance, observability, security, auditing, whatever it is else it is that you need to implement your governance of your data products. So this is sort of the fundamental unit that we are trying to build. And what I'm going to show you in a moment is how we have built this deployable unit and the supporting platform infrastructure in order to facilitate data product development. So as I've mentioned, these components, these processing layers, can be of all sorts of different types. The different input layers and output layers, we're not just talking about one type of data product, right? A data product is not necessarily a data set. You could make it a table in a data warehouse, I suppose, if you wanted to. You could certainly define it in that way. But I think that what we want to do is we want to say, you know, data products should be able to read from multiple different types of sources, and there should be a standardized way for doing that. We should be able to write to multiple different output ports, and there should be a standardized way of doing that. And then what we want to do is sort of remove all of the burden from the data product developer from having to implement that logic and let them focus only in the processing layer where they have to implement their business logic. So essentially what we want to do is we want to make it so easy for people to work with data that all they have to do is implement whatever their business logic is and then allow them to deploy the data product easily. The governance layer here is a bit more complex, as I've mentioned in the last slide. We do want to do things like monitoring observability, access control, etc. But one of the questions that I often get is, okay, if we build a data mesh, where does our data catalog live? Or how do we do a knowledge graph on a data product? And I'll show you in a moment that some of these questions become obsolete in the data mesh architecture. So let's start getting to more practice and a little bit less theory. So what we want to do with a data product is we sort of have this platform layer, and we want to interact with this platform layer in the easiest way possible. So oftentimes when we build data products, what happens is developers have to do a lot of infrastructure, they have to do a lot of systems development, they have to do all sorts of creating tables setting up buckets or reading from streams or whatever, right? There's a lot of work that has to be done that's not implementing business logic. Or data product teams are busy tracking down data quality issues. You know, an analyst comes to them and says, why is this data like this? And they say, I don't know, I'm just a data engineer, but I'll ask whoever does know. And then it goes back and forth and it takes weeks, and this is a very common pathology. What we want to do is we want to make it as easy as possible. So I'm sorry, it's a little bit small. There's a lot on this diagram. What we want to do is the data product developer is here, and what we aim for is that all she needs to do is define the business logic, so the data product code, whatever the transformations are, and then define a specification for how the data product is set up. So we want to make it as easy as possible. There's a deployment process which goes into sort of the data product experience plane. It reads the data product specification, it does some magic about putting the code in the right places, but mostly what it does is it goes down to the infrastructure utility plane and configures the infrastructure that is needed to execute that data product. Once that's done and it deploys the product, then you have this nice little hexagonal thingy here, and inside that hexagonal thingy is everything that you need to do your full end-to-end process. We set it up for you automatically. So if you need a pipeline, you specify your pipeline in your data product specification. You don't have to do pipeline engineering. It builds the pipeline for you once you have the specifications. And then you have the different input ports and output ports. So what do we actually want to do with this sort of data mesh experience? So what we really want is to make data product development easy. As I mentioned, a data product is a deployable unit. A data product should also be declarable. So we don't want to write a lot of, we don't want to write scripting. I see a lot of data engineers doing a lot of scripting. Scripting is fine to solve some problems, but you know, it leads to a lot of untestable code. It's hard to maintain, tends to bloat. We want to declare things, right? We do this with infrastructure, right? We have Terraform, we have CloudFormation, we have all these tools. We build CI/CD pipelines in this way, so let's build data products in this way. Each product should be self-contained, meaning it has everything that you need to execute right there in a template. Now, it's not as easy as a Docker container because there's so much more that you have to do with data, but it should be as self-contained as you can make it. And then, again, data product developers only worrying about solving the business problem. Again, domain ownership of data products is very important, so that business logic is now therefore owned by the domain, which makes a lot more sense than giving that business logic to some centralized team that doesn't understand the business case or the context. Couple more slides. So now we're going to get into what we're actually going to build. So this is what our data product architecture looks like in this reference implementation. We set up sort of a very self-contained piece of infrastructure. We have one AWS account per what we call a domain team. Won't really get into that in this because it's just sort of a demo implementation. We don't really have domains. We'll set up S3 buckets for ingest and output. We will set up Amazon's managed Airflow service. We'll set up an EMR cluster for Spark. We can even spin up a GitLab repo where we can keep all of our code. And then in the platform layer, what we also have are we have CloudWatch for logging. We have Apache Atlas as a data catalog. And then we have some key management, open policy agent things in the governance layer to manage the infrastructure, so to speak. And so what we do is, as a data product developer, I'm going to come up with a specification. I'm going to have a single command to deploy, to register and deploy that specification. It's going to spin up the architecture that I need, and then I'm going to have a data product that I can develop. Now, the actual process of this takes like 20 minutes or so, so I'm not going to make you sit here and wait while it spins up architecture. I've already spun up some of it, but I will walk you through the process by creating a new data product. So, let's do this for real. I'm going to drop that, and hopefully you can see this. Is this big enough for the audience? Can you see the text, or should I make it bigger? Excellent. So what I'm going to do is I have a data mesh command, and we have a couple of different arguments here. And so the first thing I want to do is initialize a data product. So I'm going to do data mesh init, and I'm going to call it Emily's Øredev product. OK, so now it has created a specification. And if I look here, I see this .spec file. Now, if I go over to my development environment, I have this sort of empty specification. Right? This specification file, it's basically JSON. Let me make it a JSON file here, give it the nice little highlighting. It allows me to specify a name for the product. I can specify who the owner is. I always forget to change this, so I'm going to do that now. Hope everyone's all right. It allows us to define the input ports, the output ports, and the steps in the processing layer. And so what we're going to do, and I'm just going to sort of copy this from what I've already spun up, is I'll show you where it's sort of living. So we have Apache Atlas, as I mentioned, for our data catalog. And let me switch to the new interface. And I have a way of registering my data product specs. So the one I started earlier is called Øredev. So let's see what we have here. I have this Øredev employee data product specification. Now it's called employee not because of like the employees here, but because I'm inheriting this from the model that we have, which was sort of a demo implementation to track interviewing processes at ThoughtWorks. So if I click on this this specification, and I scroll down, I can see the JSON, the spec JSON. It's hard to read in this small screen. Normally, it's a little bit bigger. But you can see the entire specification of the data product. If I look at the data product, and I look at the, I can go to my data products in the catalog, I can actually look at the lineage, and I can see what the output ports are that I'm reading from. So the output ports of some other upstream data product that we don't see here. I'm reading from the employee hired event, and I'm reading from the employee POH event. POH means something for us in ThoughtWorks, it doesn't matter. And then I'm going to say, OK, I'm going to create this employee data product. It's going to take this information together somehow, and I'm going to use it to get some employee details, perhaps. Maybe what office they're attached to, what their role is, stuff like that. So what I want to do is I want to create the specification for this. So I'm going to save some steps. I'm going to show you what I've already done. If we look at the input ports for one of these, this is sort of just a very easy way to define what are the data sets attached to the input ports, what's the name, what is the type of input port, in this case it's a stream, what's the name of the stream. So essentially, how do we define the input port in relation to the output port of an upstream product? I can then define the data sets, and I give each one a schema. And then this is basically just a standard schema definition that gives us the names of the fields, the types, et cetera. Now, what's interesting about this is I can just specify the fields that I want. I don't have to take all of the fields from the upstream product. I can just take the ones that I care about. So I do this for both of my input ports. So maybe I will collapse this. So I have two input ports here, as you can see. The first one was the employee hired event coming from this employee event stream. And the second one is this employee primary organizational home. That's what POH means. It's an employee POH event. It's coming from a POH assigned stream. And I'm reading from that. And again, I'm defining the schema in a declarative way. Now, this is a pretty basic implementation. Other things that we could do that we're working on, as I define the fields, I can also define quality properties that I'm expecting so that as I read things in, I can do automatic checking against them. So I do that for the input ports. Same thing for the output ports. This is what I'm declaring that I'm going to be emitting. So I'm saying I'm giving an employee record. It's going to have this data. I'm going to join it together from these two upstream products in some way. I'm going to emit this data. As you can see, we can have sort of nested output structures here. And that's basically it. I'm just going to define that in relation to the data set. And I'm going to say this is a batch type, right? So this is not a streaming event. I'm just doing this on some schedule. I'm emitting this to some place. And actually, as I mentioned before, we're pushing it to an S3 bucket. So what this will do is just take in that data and pump it to an S3 bucket. And then I define the processing steps, which is basically taking the employee event. I'm going to create a harmonization process. Same thing for the POH event. These are the steps that are going to exist, or the DAGs that are going to exist in my pipeline. So each one of these processes defines a DAG in Airflow. So I'm just going to take all of this, and I'll show you how I sort of register this. I'm just going to do a little copy-paste, but I'm going to give it a new name. Instead of Øredev employee data product, I'll call it Emily's Øredev employee data product, right? OK, so now I have a specification. So then I'm going to go and register. I'm going to publish the specification, OK? So I'm going to do publish spec. And what did I call it? Emily Øredev product. Emily Øredev product. And if this works OK, hopefully it will. Yes, it does. This will register the product in the Apache Atlas catalog. If I'm lucky, it has already shown up, and indeed it has. So there it is. So with that command, I've now registered my data product. Anyone else working in the data mesh can discover that this data product has been registered. Then what I want to do is I want to deploy it. So there's a deployment command. It is data mesh deploy. I can also do data mesh list deployments to show all of the other data products that that have been deployed. Oops, that doesn't work. Anyways, so let's just deploy this data product. I left out a parameter for the list deployments that I forget which it was. Nope. That's not right. Just copy this the right way. I need the data product name, and I'm going to do deploy and the data product name, and this will kick off a process. Yes, it worked. This will kick off a process of setting up the infrastructure. So now as we speak, all of this is going into our cloud platform. It is processing this. It's looking at the schema, validating the schema. It will throw an error if there's something wrong. I actually might have left a bug in there. We'll see. And this will deploy a data product. So let me show you what it actually goes and deploys. So if I go to AWS, I mentioned that it's already going to set up an S3 bucket. It's going to set up managed Apache Airflow. It's going to set up some CloudWatch. And I can go and look at all of these. I'll look at the one that I've set up before. As I mentioned, I'm not going to make you all sit here and wait for 20 minutes. So let's just see what buckets we have. So now you can see we have the employee details Øredev product. This is the output port, the input port, the hired event, the POH event for all of that. So everything is set up. That's what I just created. What I created before the talk are these here, the Øredev employee. Again, it's also creating buckets for my computing layer, my control port, et cetera. Then if I go to managed Apache Airflow, I can see that it has created this Øredev employee data product environment for me. Has created the EMR instance that will run all of the code, creates the Airflow cluster for me. I can open the Airflow UI, takes a minute. And then you can see the different processes, right? So I have the employee harmonizer that I defined in my specification and the POH harmonizer that I also defined. I can click into here. I can look at the steps. So I have a couple of different processes, right? So I create a job flow that's basically initializing it. I add these steps. I'll show you what this looks like. Basically, it's just a Spark submit job. I'm giving it this application.jar file. This is a standardized ingestion process, so I don't have to write any of this code. This is sort of the default template that it gives me, and it's telling me where the schema path is, where the data path is, what's the output path, what's the error path. All of that is defined in relation to the parameters that I set up. Once this is all initialized, when I run the DAGs, it runs this jar file, it does the processing, everything is happy. And then I can also go back and see, you know, what are the steps that have processed. I ran this earlier. It's not actually hooked up to anything, so it failed. But I can also look at sort of what are the other steps that we have in the DAG. There's one other thing that I can do. If I go here, I have this flag, has custom code. Let's suppose that that basic ingestion script, that jar file that I just mentioned, let's suppose that we don't actually want to use that. We need to do some custom processing. I can give this flag called has custom code. And this, of course, sets up a GitLab repository for me. So when I do that, and I click on the Øredev employee data product, it gives me this templated Git repo that has everything that I need to do whatever my custom development is. So I can go into the source directory, I can go into my resources file, I can look at my resources, DAGs. I can look at my Python code for my DAGs. If I wanted to do custom DAGs, I can do that all right here. I can also do that in the sort of definition of the DAGs in the specification. I could create other processes, a SQL job if I'm connecting to a database, whatever. All of that can be done in here. So it sets all of that up for you and gives you also the testing harness so that you can, of course, test all of your transformations. So once we do all of that and we deploy that, now we have a data product pretty much already defined. The next thing that we want to do, if I can go back to the slides, is if you notice down at the bottom here, we mentioned this thing about data product lifecycle management, requesting access, approving and rejecting access. This is the complex reality of real data systems. You don't want to be able to necessarily give everyone access to every data product. There's PII, there's confidential information, whatever. So we want to do that in a granular way. We have also implemented that to a lesser extent in the data mesh command line. So if you see here, I have the request for access. So if I needed to connect to an upstream data product, I would request for access. If I wanted to see who's looking at my data products, I can do a list access request. I can approve that, or I can reject that from the command line. We can also build this into other tooling, of course, make it more API-driven. But for right now, we're able to do this purely from the command line. And that allows us to essentially build that mesh of data products. Now, this was just one data product, but we want to be able to do this over and over and over. So again, the goal was to make this a repeatable and deployable process. Essentially, what we want to do is we built sort of the right half of this mesh. But if we start doing this over and over, what we're actually doing is building a data product here. And this takes input ports and emits an output port. And then that output port becomes an input port for what we just built, and so on and so forth. So you do this all the way down. And this is lineage is automatically generated through our data catalog. What's interesting about this is that, as I mentioned earlier, like, where do I put my knowledge graph in this? You don't need to. Because we're defining all of our data products in a declarative format, what we can do is just take all of those data product definitions, and we can infer the full knowledge graph directly from the definitions, right? So we've taken a significant burden away from our data systems and put it into a way that we're sort of encoding directly in the data product specification. This is a real time saver, and when we have sort of open source tools like Apache Atlas that give us API-based access, it really simplifies the burden of maintaining the data products within a data mesh, maintaining the quality of the data. You don't have to do all of this sort of scanning of your data lake and stuff like that that other catalogs need to do. What that means is that if we look back at Apache Atlas, and this is something that we're trying to implement now, is I can look at any data product, and I can start defining other properties. I can define SLOs. So what's my accuracy guarantee? What's my latency guarantee? I can define contextual information. So what is the meaning of fields? What's the relevant context for the data product in the business context? I can define all of that and deploy it with the same mechanism that I'm using to deploy my data product. That makes it much easier for us to find the right quality data. It also solves the problem of worrying about single source of truth. Because when you can go and you can look at, okay, which data products have this data and make it available, you can trace it back to the source, or you can find where that data is giving you the SLO guarantees that you need. So it actually doesn't matter which source what's coming from, as long as you can show that there's SLO compliance through that entire through the entire mesh. And so finally, I will sort of wrap it up, to give you a couple minutes for questions. What comes next with this? I mentioned, or there's one thing I didn't mention, sorry, is that there's this sort of data product sidecar that we create. This is to help us with the governance aspect. So this is how the data product actually speaks to Apache Atlas. If I wanted to, say I'm creating this batch access, if I wanted to grant access selectively to certain fields, to certain downstream users, I need a way to sort of have a query layer or some other layer to filter out who can see what. So if they go to the bucket, there's no way of me controlling which fields they see. So I need a better way to do that. So one way to do that is to use the data product sidecar as a sort of a JDBC layer that you can put that sort of row level control on, field level control, whatever, that is integrated with your identity policy. The other thing that we're experimenting with right now is actually using key management solutions for this. So you give people, you grant and revoke keys to access the data. So they could always pull the data, but it's encrypted. They can't actually read from it unless they have the key. And so the sidecar can help mediate that key exchange to grant that access. So that's one thing that we're working on. We're also working on just sort of building out the different output port templates. So right now we're doing it to S3. We can read from streams. But there's all sorts of output ports. I mean, in the real world, you're pushing things to other streams. You're creating GraphQL APIs, REST APIs. emitting CSV files, writing to a Google spreadsheet on Google Cloud. I've done that. It's not the greatest thing to do, but it's the reality. And also providing more configurability, right? So when you look at the data product definition, we create an Airflow instance for every data product. We create a Spark instance EMR for every data product. That can get a little pricey. You might say, well, Emily, we can take that, we can push that down into the platform layer and just create a networking between those. That is true, but it's more work for us. That's what we're working on now. So that's all I have. Thank you for bearing with me, and I have exactly 5 minutes to give you for questions. Before I take your question, I just want to give a shout out to my coworkers, Atif and Sumedha. They're the ones that actually built this. So I'll be happy to answer your questions to the extent that I can, but they know the more specific details. Yeah, that's a great question. So what we envision is to use the sort of declarations of the output ports and the input ports to match them and create a sort of consumer-driven contract test with that, so that we can do all sorts of things like if you change that schema, you might just want to create a new version of an output port as a parallel output port, kind of like what we do with like V1, V2 APIs, and so that you commit to still writing the old schema in parallel with the new schema. That's one way of doing it. We could also do things like you only roll forward, so you don't deprecate other fields until all of your consumers have also deprecated that field. This makes it a little bit easier to implement that, because once you're registering those data products with the catalog, you can actually take yours, you can walk that graph to figure out who's using what and where it's coming from. There are still things like, let's say I define an output port called last name, and then the downstream product defines an output port called last name. You would assume that those are the same things, but they may not be. There still needs to be a level of control there. We don't know. I don't have the answers for things like that. But what we want to do is solve some of the schema drift problems through contract testing, through data quality control, rather than kind of giving the total freedom to every team to just build whatever without any care about how that affects the downstream. I think this makes it a bit easier, but it's not a solved problem yet. Anything else? Yes?
I think this is really interesting. I mean, it solves a lot of problems. But in the same way as microservices did for the system development, but microservices also introduced a bunch of new problems. So for example, like debugging,
the answer is yes and. There's a lot that microservices has already given us, right? So when we look at, when I mention SLOs, like I've done a little bit of work with like SRE theory. I mean those in the very SRE sense, right? Not in the way that a lot of product folks kind of misuse the term. So we can take some of that theory that has been applied and really works in microservices, right? So we know how to do observability. We need to redefine some of that for data products. It doesn't make sense to do like latency for a data product. It makes sense to do latency for data, but you know, you're writing a query, it could take 10 minutes. That's not a good SLO. So we need to redefine some of that. Some of the tooling, quite frankly, is not there yet. The sort of granular access control that I'm talking about when we create a data mesh, if you're using some tools, and I'm not going to name them because I'll get in trouble, but there are some tools that don't really sort of jive with that, because they do expect to be a monolithic thing in the middle. A lot of those tooling vendors are saying, yes, we support data mesh, but it's kind of like a lot of ad hoc wrappers around it, and so that makes it hard for debugging. I think that debugging in data is hard anyways, because you have to do a lot of searching through the logs. There's a lot of, debugging Spark can be very complicated. Data quality is a very hard problem to solve generally. Those problems don't go away, and so it does create that. However, I think that what this does is that when you start combining the knowledge that we have from microservices and how to restore systems and how to observe systems better, then you're able to do a lot more granular control, and that will hopefully solve that problem. But you're right, the tooling is not fully there yet. I'm hoping it will get there, and you know, we'll keep seeing. Anything else? Please, by all means. Thank you. We do. So this is built on our experience building this. So this particular implementation came out of work that we did with an American healthcare company. We are also working on data mesh with some other organizations. I think if you go to our website, there's some published. We work with Roche, for example. I think I can mention that. To help them build a data mesh and working on things like solving the governance challenges and solving the platform challenges and other things like that. So we've built various implementations of data mesh with various clients. And I think that some of these, the examples that you're seeing are us synthesizing the early ways that we've been doing that with some. And I think that now in the past year, 2 years really, we do have some quite mature data mesh implementations at our clients. Unfortunately, I can't show you what we've done with them, but this is sort of along the same line of thinking. I think some of the challenges to that are oftentimes you go to a client and you know you want to do things like set up one AWS account per domain. They don't let you do that. So then what do you do? Or they don't have the capability. They don't have like people that can write Spark at scale. So how would you support this data mesh transformation? Right? It's as much an organizational change as it is a technical change. And so what I didn't talk about today is all of the organizational change that has to go along with that, much like microservices required a different way to set up your teams, your responsibilities, you need to define product owners, things like that. So there are challenges there, but we do have working live data meshes, for sure. Yes, so when you deploy the product, so anytime you change the code in that repo, it basically redeploys the product. It's the same thing like a microservices, or like a Docker container deployment. Yes. Yes. Yes, the data product definition includes the data, the schema, the semantic context, the pipelines, the output ports, the input ports, and the SLOs. So all of those things combined make a data product. So it's tooling, definitions, standards, all of that. So let me see if I understand right. So if you wanted to create like a test product, like you're experimenting, would you do that in production or would you do that elsewhere? I mean, that's a good question. I think like everything else, you have a test environment, a test deployment. We would expect that you sort of develop in continuous delivery practices. That's also a part of data mesh, right? So I would say that with a sort of a demo product, you would deploy it, you develop it and deploy it in the same way that you would develop a microservice. In practice, that's not always feasible because with data, often a lot of your data product hangs on the actual data itself. Like you can't, you need the full data set in order to make the data product. And in that case, then I would say that it's actually okay to develop in prod because you know, it's just a node in a mesh at that point, right? It's not a critical load-bearing component. Eventually, it might become that. In practice, we see, you know, you have data products that are like holding master data. Those become very load-bearing. But I would say that, you know, if you're just building like a downstream analytics product, absolutely, you can just develop in prod. It depends on the context and what you need to do. Obviously, I would like to see, you know, nice, proper, you know, continuous delivery deploy to test, have the quality gates, automate your deployment to prod after that. But I'm a data scientist, so I know the real the challenges of working with real data. All right, anything else? Cool, well, thank you again for joining. I hope this was helpful. I'm happy to talk. Cool.